staring. Oh, lost the staring contest. No, there he is again.
All right, guys. Show you the full view of the Christmas scene at the Bucci's. All right, our tree. We got a fake Christmas tree, pre-lit. Don't judge us. We got red and silver, and then a silver star up there. And I really wanted to get some lights to do this. It looks awesome. I'm obsessed with it.
And then Koopy.
And then we got another like just tabletop decoration of, wow, words. Tabletop decoration over here. So it's just white branches, pine cones, some red shit, and this thing, vase. In the meantime, we also got some new pillows. Actual throw pillows as opposed to bed pillows. And our little bookshelf on the coffee table here.
Hello, sir.
He like, aww, look. This is the cutest thing ever.
Mom, will you marry me?
Oh, that is so cute. Thank you for your paw. Aww, are you gonna lay down? All right, back to the Christmas stuff. Last but not least, we have some garland on the TV stand. And yeah, we're excited about it. Merry Christmas, babe.
Merry Christmas.
Come on. He gets so interested when the camera comes around. Good morning, YouTube.
Cooper.
Nope. I'm still staring at myself. Good morning, YouTube. Emma and I are filming, and he's just... Emma's trying to get him to not chew on that in the middle of filming. We have her camera and some lights.
And Cooper just being Cooper.
He's the cutest, but he's a handful for sure. Thank you to everybody on my Instagram who taught me some helpful tips for getting him to not bite. They've actually helped a ton. And if you guys are, I'm gonna like compile a list of them. Anyway, it's a work in progress, but thank you guys so much for all your help. I super appreciate it because his breed is just, you know, he's a puppy number one, his breed is naturally a biter number two. So learning how to positively reinforce what's good to bite and punish in a way what's not good to bite is learning a process, but it's fun. Okay, hello everybody. You can see me, we're good. What's going on everyone? I'm just popping on here because this is the whole title of the video. I wanted to come on and just talk to you like I used to talk to you guys and just be myself, be Amanda, talking to you, my YouTube friends, in the way that I just want to be open, transparent, honest like I used to be. And I feel like we've both been feeling this way for quite a while. Obviously there's been a huge like disconnect between me and YouTube and how I used to make videos and how I make them now and how often I used to make them and how often I make them now. And I wanted to just give you guys like an inside look into my mind and my thought process behind everything, because I've been thinking about this a lot. I really want to get back on YouTube. Like, I am motivated to. And before, there was this feeling of being really not motivated to make videos. I was trying to just be self-aware and decipher like why I was feeling stuck on YouTube. Not necessarily that my views were going down, why, like I totally know why. If you guys are curious and thinking that, why do you coach people how to grow their social media when you can't even sustain your own YouTube channel? Like, if for those people, I haven't been making a lot of videos, and YouTube rewards creators who consistently upload and who consistently upload things that people like. And I've been uploading different content and really inconsistently, so they are not as rewarded. Like, they're super different. Obviously, a lot of the stuff that I've been posting is not a full day of eating, or they're not like workout videos, or they're not prep videos, and those kinds of things that have really helped me grow my channel to the size that it is now. That being said, a lot of the disconnect has come from a couple of different things, and I just wanted to explain what I think they are in my head, and then what my resolution is and what my next steps are gonna be. So In my head, originally, I started taking steps back from YouTube. Number one, just because I started to get really busy, and I know that's like the worst excuse ever because I always tell people that if they really want to make YouTube a priority, they will make YouTube a priority. But when I was growing my channel, and the reason that it got to the size that it is now, is because I was consistently making so many videos. Like, I have 430 videos. I don't know how I did that, but the only thing that I did at a certain point was do competition preps. I was doing fitness coaching and getting paid for sponsorships and commission from PE Science and Bite Meals and other companies that I still work with now, but that was like my only form of income for a while aside from fitness coaching. So if you guys saw my last video, I did that little flow chart, like me posting on YouTube or Instagram and then like either clients or either commission sponsorship stuff. And it was really awesome. And it wasn't that at that point too. I wasn't just on YouTube for that reason, and I'm still not. Like, I started YouTube and I started Instagram just because I liked doing it. I liked sharing. It was really fun. But at a certain point, I knew that there was more that I could do, and I knew that there was a bigger impact that I could make if I could make more money, if I can make bigger businesses, and not just for myself. I think a lot of people feel like there's a massive disconnect between understanding a person and understanding what businesses are. And I am from the side of those who make really good money can seriously change the world. Like, those are the only people that have the ability to make major shifts in the world. So if you want to change shit in the world, figure out how to build some businesses and make a ton of money, because money is everywhere. I want to do a full podcast or video, maybe YouTube video, on just money mindset, because once I figured out how to make it and how to like actually change lives of people in the process, like my clients and my students, I love them, and they've all just had massive changes in their lives internally, externally, and I wouldn't have been able to do that with them and for them and then do other things in the world that I think are so amazing, like the Pencils of Promise campaign and all these other things that I wanna do and be able to donate. I've donated to a bunch of different charities this year, just like silently, just because I want to and not because I can. Been able to fly home a couple of different times and been able to have my mom fly out and visit me, all these things. Regardless, you can do amazing things, and people do amazing things who are wealthy, I guess you could say. And people who aren't still do amazing things, but for the most part, and in my experience, I was so focused on just being able to pay my bills that I couldn't think about anything or anybody else except for myself. And that's just a large majority of America, and that's just reality. So that is one thing, and I think I lost my train of thought there. But back to the whole business separation thing, I just started getting really busy, and I started, you know, focusing more on my clients and building my businesses, and I got a boyfriend about a year ago. We just celebrated our 1 year anniversary, and I got a puppy. He's here under the table in the office sleeping, and it's the cutest thing. Actually focusing more on myself and focusing more on like having a shut off time. And now I feel like my days are set up just like I have a regular office job. Like, I usually work between 9 and 4, go to the gym after work, and then, you know, I try to shut off at night. So creating content and videos has been way more of a struggle because I have to like fit it in certain parts of the day, and then I have to like switch the person that I'm being, essentially going from like typing on my computer to like making a video to making a podcast. And what I've really, really learned that really helps is to separate out what you're doing. So if you guys are feeling this way in your own businesses or just in your own life, having specific times of days or specific days in general that you are being like a content creator and you're being like in your regular job, and then you're being, you know, shutting off from everything, and then you're doing like the computer work and like the legal stuff and the boring stuff. Having that all separated out so your mind isn't constantly shifting really helps. But I've just been struggling with adding in like, okay, let me make this video and let me do this, and it's just something that has like fallen by the wayside. So that's number one reason. And the number two reason is obviously the content that I've been making is a little bit different. So this year I stopped competing. I did my Project Me, I did my cut, it was really great. I was going to do a full-on reverse diet, but I just started intuitively eating and it feels amazing. And there's a podcast coming out about it in December, so stay tuned for that on Bucci Radio. I'm doing a full like how I did it podcast. Excited about that, but I didn't feel the need to like eat more and reverse diet and continue tracking. I just feel so good and normal, and it feels really good. So I haven't had like a really specific fitness goal in terms of nutrition and training for a while. I'm going to come January. Again, I'm not doing anything super drastic, but I am going to start sticking to a goal just in terms of training mostly, honestly, because when it comes to training, I do feel like there's just been this weird limbo phase where I'm not motivated to train, but I do still want to go to the gym, but I want to do kind of a little bit of everything. I want to still do squats and deadlifts and bench press, but I also want to do cardio HIIT style workouts, but I also want to do mobility, and then I also don't want to go to the gym that many days a week, so I'm just a little bit all over the place with my training, but I'm still going, I'm still training, I'm still eating really normally. I eat pretty much the same thing every single day, going on like date nights once a week with Brian and stuff like that, but that has been like another aspect where I'm like not doing anything new and interesting with fitness. So I could make fitness videos. I've made a million informational fitness videos and I feel like I could just recycle that information and keep doing that, but that was another spark for me to want to share like the business stuff and the social media growth stuff and the mindset personal development stuff, because that's what I'm learning this year. That's what I love. I've been reading a ton of books, listening to a ton of podcasts, and I'm just like chomping at the bit to share all that stuff. But some people, not all of you guys, obviously a lot of you are really excited about it, so it's not necessarily that I'm just not making it because some people don't like it, but some people are like, yo, bitch, all you care about is money. Why are you doing this? You're greedy, you're scammy, you're this. So I've tried to tell myself that that hasn't been something that has stopped me from making YouTube videos, but internally it definitely is. It's definitely something where I'm just like, guards up a little bit, like, wall, wall, there's a wall here. A small one, it's thin, but it's not like a thick wall because I'm still here showing up a couple like times a month, but that's just been something in my head. So I have to get over that for myself. I do wanna make more content just based around, you know, what I actually do for a living now and how I coach people to do it on their own. And that brings up an entirely new topic, which is what I want to address in this video. A couple of things that I feel I haven't been as transparent about when it comes to like my businesses, and that's where I feel like a lot of the Amanda's a scam artist and just greedy and money hungry and she charges a lot for her programs and she's not qualified, all that stuff. I haven't spoken up about it. Because I'm over here like trying to convince people that I'm a good person is pretty low on my priority list because I know I am, and a lot of people who just get it know that I am. So convincing everybody else, I'm like, all right, I'll do it eventually. I don't like confrontation. I'd rather just like let it be and just know that I'm doing good things and I'm well intended and all my students are like getting what they're paying for and all that stuff. But I wanted to do that today just because I'm just clearing the air here in terms of making this video. I'm just like, yo, this is everything that's going on. So I talked to Taryn Gilligan. She's a YouTuber too, and she's an Instagrammer, a digital marketer, and she just wanted to say like, yo, this is what it looks like from the outside. This is what I see. This is what you could probably do better, just in terms of being transparent about like what exactly I do in my business. That last video that I did was pretty transparent about like, here's how it looks, but just in terms of my companies and what happens inside of them in terms of the coaching aspect, let's dive into that stuff.
Oh, you're so tired.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh, who's so sleepy?
I love him.
Coop's looking at me all funny. Okay, so I'm gonna go through a list of questions that Taryn actually came up with, and I'm just gonna address them because they're just probably just percolating in the air. Number one, why are you not certified? Why should people get certified through an academy where one of the two co-founders isn't even a certified personal trainer? William is a certified personal trainer. He was actually a personal trainer for years before he transitioned online. It was just 8 years ago, so he was a personal trainer. I am not a personal trainer or a certified personal trainer because in my fitness journey, I never wanted to be a personal trainer. I never wanted to go into a gym and be a personal trainer. I became an online fitness coach slightly with some ignorance to this whole situation, I suppose, and I just kind of started doing it because people were asking, and I was one of those people where I knew I have enough information and I know that there's all of these dumb as fuck coaches. Sorry, this is like lack of professional. I'm just being myself. Idiotic coaches who destroy people's lives, and I know that I can actually help people and I have the information. I was one of those people that just hustled to get my knowledge from everywhere else because I was diving in so deeply and I loved it. And yes, of course, I mean, I came from a science background in nursing school. I know everything about the human body, anatomy, physiology, drugs, all that kind of thing. I knew all of that, so I knew that I could apply all of that to what I learned about fitness. Obviously, I was never a certified personal trainer, did not become one, and then I decided to create a certification program. Number one, it is currently a certificate program, so it's a certificate of completion. We are so heavily focused on working towards accreditation and certification, but it's a huge, long work in progress. I've talked about this a couple of times. It takes a long time to get it there. So currently just focusing on serving our clients the way that we want to, make sure that they're getting everything out of it as humanly possible. And we are promoting quality coaching within the program. So I know it may not come across as such because I am not a certified personal trainer and I never was. We are promoting coaches who are intelligent, who know what they're talking about, who know what they're doing. William and I, and then all of the other people that we have as contributors are intelligent and they do know what they're doing. They are experts, they are professionals, and we are doing our best to promote quality, competent, knowledgeable coaches. If you want to get a certification from a personal training course, that's totally fine. And I actually think that FOCA and personal training courses are both problematic in a way because there's nothing that combines the two currently. So what we're working towards is a solution for what this currently doesn't have a solution for. And what I mean by that is that for most people, everybody that I have talked to who has taken a personal training course does not feel, this is like not me saying this, does not feel that what they learned actually helped them train their clients as much as actual experience and knowledge did, and as much as just learning from other people did. Just because there's some stuff that's probably outdated in there, there's some like slight lack of practical knowledge, aside from a couple of things that I've heard are really great, like precision nutrition I've heard is really great in terms of practicality and that side of it, but the bigger ones I've heard, again, don't know, don't necessarily serve people in that way. So we're trying to serve people in that way, but also have all the aspects that the higher level massive businesses have, like NASM and ACE and all of that, including continued education, so CEU, which we currently can't do because we aren't accredited, but we're working towards that. We're also working towards creating, again, this is all like long-term stuff that I have totally considered. I just haven't really voiced here, and I feel like that's a lot of people's concerns. We have considered discounting for military, veterans, people that typically can get discount students, stuff like that. But we did research and we could do that. But again, it's not a certification and accredited, so that's typically done for by like the government. Again, need to relook at the articles that I read when I was researching this. It was a few months ago in the middle of FOCA, but we just didn't put it out there yet because we're just not there yet. But we're working on it and it's in our heads and it's something that is in our long-term game plan for FOCA. Other things, illnesses, special populations, illness and disease, client assessments. Do we have any sections on that? And yes, we actually have a section on, I'm sorry if this is so long, by the way, if you guys don't care, just skip past this. So we also have a section on when to outsource to other disciplines. So if you do have a client or a potential client who seems to have an eating disorder and is not recovered, how to outsource to a registered dietitian or a psychologist or a therapist or another specialty. People who might have actual health problems where fitness coaches can't help them, how to outsource to a doctor, a physical therapist, a chiropractor, those kinds of people who are actual professionals and need to help in that way because fitness coaches cannot. So we're actually doing our absolute best to be on the forefront of changing the industry for the better with this program. And I know that it's in this state right now where it's not there yet. But we do feel like it's still worth the amount because it's still serving people in the way that they want to be served in terms of growing an online business and entrepreneurship. It's not like these people are taking a certification who purchase it and go to a LA Fitness or a Gold's Gym and say, hey, I just got certified, can I work here? And it doesn't count for anything, like it's not real. You're just building your own business, you're an entrepreneur, and you don't need any permission from anybody to do that, aside from just your own self-learning, you know, tools and strategies and courses. So that's the basis of that focus stuff. If Influencer Academy, which there is like, what is the difference between the two, teaches you how to be the best coach you can possibly be, which is what she wrote, why do I need to get certified through FOCA? Number one, you don't need to get certified through anything. You need to just do whatever you feel is best for you based on your own knowledge, experience, and research in different products and courses. But Influencer Academy is different because it's actually a pretty high level mentorship coaching program. So it doesn't teach you nutrition, training, client assessment management. We go through that because online coaches are in the program and they talk through that, how everyone does their check-ins and stuff, but it's not taught necessarily because it's taught in FOCA. So FOCA is actually learning about macronutrients, micronutrients, training program design, cardio, intermittent fasting, caloric surpluses and deficits, how to adjust your clients' programs, all of that stuff. And then Influencer Academy is how to grow your business, social media strategy, Instagram posting, your business strategy, how to actually get clients, sales, all of that stuff. So they're pretty separate, but they actually just work with each other, if that makes sense. Last but not least, I just wanted to address Influencer Academy. Again, I'm not addressing these things to just be defensive. I'm not addressing these things to put the haters down or whatever. I just feel like I took a step back because I was like, whoa, hold on. I don't really want to do conflict here. I just want to focus on serving my clients and my business. But I also feel like it's really important for just me to be transparent and answer these questions because I know that they're just up in the air for a lot of people. And I want to be honest with you guys, like I said in the beginning. So Influencer Academy, the first, she, again, Taryn listed out like the objections that people have and just made it really just easy to read. So I'm like looking over here. In terms of, let me see, me not having enough experience to be a business coach. So a lot of people see on the outside looking in that I grew my Instagram, fitness, have a nice body, some people have like the look, I collab with a lot of people. Yes, that was great. That definitely was what helped me grow my social media accounts. However, this year I invested in my own coaching program. It was quite a lot of money. It was learning from the best people in the business, people who essentially, if you were taking maybe a digital marketing course or an entrepreneurship course in college, it would be kind of like that, but doing it for yourself at the same exact time, plus learning from people who have already made tens of millions of dollars themselves in their own businesses, who are really high level people. So it's essentially like having professors who are the most successful people in the business and actually implementing everything you've learned in the process. So that's what I have done for myself this year in terms of experience. Other experience was just from myself. So with this program, I didn't want it to be, here's how I did it, learned from what I did, and then get like me to post you on my Instagram story so you get a couple more hundred followers. Totally not that at all. I've broken down what I believe and I've learned to be the actual business and social media strategies that help anybody grow. So I've had people go from like no followers to 15,000 followers. And again, everyone's individual, but I didn't just say, here's what I did, copy me. And I also didn't just say, here's my audience, take them. I'm saying, here's what you can do in your personal situation. It's a high level coaching program and it's expensive because it's high touch. Like, I'm with these people every day in the Facebook group. We do multiple phone calls a week, working through each person's strategy, and everyone has the opportunity to speak, to share their struggles and say, hey, I'm struggling with this. And then there I am to say, hey, take this strategy and utilize this more. You could probably be doing this in a better way. And having that kind of consulting section of it, actually, it's not just how to be an influencer. I'm actually doing consulting with these people for their specific businesses. So it's social media consulting, business consulting, and personal development on a customized level for each client. It's not cookie cutter. It's not, here's just a program and do it on your own. It's like, I am there with you throughout your whole journey. I know these people, I follow all of them on Instagram. They've become friends to me. They have the live event at the end, it's really fun. And we also have continued education, so if there's people who wanna continue on, we have an alumni program. So people who are getting to the next level, we do that. And that covers a lot of things, I think. And again, the customization of it, it's not just here's how to do something, here's how I did it, here are my followers, take them. It's here's what you should do, here's the actual foundational principles, here's also let's customize and coach you through it as you're actually doing it, and then here's how it applies to each of them specifically and moving forward in their own lives and their own businesses. So it's really, really customized and it's highly worth the value, especially if you can make that back the actual investment, which is an investment. It's not just throwing your money at something stupid. It's an investment in yourself and your business. So you can take this, invest it, and then make it back and then make more. It's basically you learning how to make more. It's like packaging up what you have to know in order to make more. And that's what an investment is. So there's that. And lastly, I just want to say that it's not just how to grow your social media following. So it's really people for people who have no business or who have a business but it's not thriving, and teaching them how to initially set up their business, how to set business goals that are realistic and attainable, how to actually reach those goals, how to create their own social media platform in their own voice with their own mission and their own people, building their own tribe, and how to do that really, really specifically, and then how to actually move forward and make it sustainable. We talk about pricing advice, legal advice, lots of stuff. So, I think I just wanted to clear the air. I hope that cleared the air. If the air is clear, it feels clear to me. I don't know if it feels clear to you guys or if it's foggy still. I also want to just talk a little bit about humanizing the business aspect of things, because I think a lot of people have also said in the past that they feel like I'm talking down to them, I'm being preachy or teachy or one of those words. And I think when I talk about something like this, I talk really fast because I'm just like, I just want to get it out there. I have a lot to say and there's a lot in my head. I'm the same person. I'm trying to not be preachy, teachy, and salesy and pushy. I'm sorry if I have been that way in the past. And that's really good criticism, so thank you. Again, I think a lot of it just comes from the disconnect between learning about business and those who don't necessarily care to be entrepreneurs, who don't want to be, who don't know anything about business, which is completely fine. Like if you have a career that you love, you shouldn't care about business because it's not your thing and that's not what you're doing. For me, when I first learned about it too, I didn't know, and there was a really huge disconnect for me about people who have businesses and run them versus me who just didn't know anything about it a couple years ago. And there's a difference. And it's not like people who run businesses aren't bad people. They're normal people. They still go through struggles. I have taken myself aback from that because I've taken myself away from the complete transparency like I was with my fitness preps and stuff like that for a lot of the reasons I said in the beginning. So I think that's another thing to kind of add into this mix here too. Thank you guys for listening to me. Again, I didn't want this to be me defending myself. It was a clear the air kind of moment for me. It was a let me just be honest and transparent with every kind of thoughts that's been rolling in my head for the last few months. I'm always open to honest constructive criticism, and constructive criticism is what saved me many, many times over this year. So YouTube and being on social media is terrifying because there's so many people that just constructively criticize you constantly. But it forces you to be better. So thank you to everyone who has given me constructive criticism. And Taryn, thank you for your time, and I appreciate this so much. Thank you all for your time listening today. I know this was a super long video. Last but not least, I am, interestingly enough, really re-motivated to start making consistent YouTube videos again. I don't know what it was. Something in me today was like, I wanna be back. And I think it was another, lastly, reason that I fell off was I got out of the habit. So I wanna get back into the habit. I'm excited about it. Bear with me. Thank you all so much for listening to this video. Comment below. Thoughts, feelings, opinions, all that stuff is totally warranted because it's valuable and you're important. Thank you guys. I'll catch you guys in the next video. Mwah.